Gal med Gunnar TV. Simply the best.
Men nå skal dere få møte Irshad Manji. Hun er selv muslim, men også en av islams sterkeste kritikere. Med fare for sitt eget liv mener hun at det største problemet med islam er muslimene selv. Welcome, Irshad Manji.
Your cup back?
Yes.
Yes, okay. There you go.
You have to sort that out first.
Exactly.
Irshad Manji, what you're saying in your book is that the biggest problem with Islam are the Muslims.
Yep.
What do you mean by that?
Well, I mean that Muslims themselves will actually say that to you behind closed doors. We'll never say that publicly, though I am very willing to say it. That, you know, there are so many beautiful verses of the Quran, one of which states, God does not change the condition of a people until they change what is inside themselves. This is a call for self-reform. And while Muslims, my fellow Muslims, are so busy pointing fingers at Israel, at America, at Western colonialism, I ask them, which of these five fingers that God has given to most of us on one hand, which of those fingers are you willing to point at yourself? I'm just asking for one. Which one? This is the challenge that we have to own for ourselves now.
It seemed like when we are discussing Islam, I mean, journalists or politicians, we are also afraid of insulting or offending someone. Mm-hmm. Why is that, do you think?
Fear. Which, at least in the English language, is the most destructive four-letter F word. Fear. And, you know, fear affects so much about how we live our lives. Liberal Muslims are afraid of being open with their views because we fear that Islam supremacists will call us sellouts and traitors. And on the other hand, Islam bashers will call us terrorists in waiting. And on the other hand, progressive non-Muslims are afraid, as you well know, Frederick, of being labeled Islamophobes, bigots, racists, simply for supporting those of us who are calling for universal human rights within the faith of Islam.
But
so there's so many layers of fear.
But how can we know? But how can we know what's offensive and not?
Well, first of all, why should you care what's offensive or not?
I don't want to offend anyone.
Well,
I mean,
you know what? That very, if I told you, let me tell you this right now. You know, you're offending me right now by, yes, you. You, handsome Frederick, you are offending me right now by suggesting, and really, this is the implication, let's be honest, that I can't handle the challenging question, that I will melt under the spotlight of your scrutiny. And I, you know, when I'm told I must respect Muslims, Irshad, I say, good, respect us by treating us as equals, by treating us as peers, not as children. Have faith in my capacity and in, frankly, the public's capacity to think critically. If we avoid the hard questions, Frederick, simply because we don't wish to offend, in fact, what people are doing, I'll say you are doing then, is insulting the intelligence of the general public.
So what you're saying is that we can say what we want and we can draw whatever drawings we'd like to draw?
Sure, why not? Why not? And I say this as a faithful Muslim. The fact is, and you're not going to hear this very often, I know, so I better take my time while I have it. The fact is that the Quran contains many passages that support freedom of expression, freedom of conscience. And so, you know, when I find it very laughable, by the way, when my fellow Muslims say to me, well, you're just, you know, what we say in American English, cherry picking. You are just being very selective about the verses. And I say, yes, I'm very honest about that. The problem is you're not honest about the fact that you're selective too. And you're selective because you're ignoring those passages in the Quran that do support freedom of expression and speech.
You are a feminist, you're gay, and you're also a Muslim.
Is that a question or a statement?
No, I'm stating.
Oh, okay.
I'm just telling the audience.
I see.
Okay. What is offensive to you? What
labels,
could be?
Those labels.
Except what I just did.
Yeah. those labels are offensive to me. But you know what? First of all, because the moment you say you are this and you are that and you are this, assumptions begin. All these labels have baggage that come with them. And then people very often fail to see the complex individual that you are. If, for example, I said, Frederick, you are white, you are male, I don't know this, but I'll assume for now, you're straight. That's my question. You know, you must think a certain way. It's absurd. It's absurd to assume, either quietly or openly, that, you know, because you have these various labels attached to you, that you must therefore do this.
I shall be careful now, but...
Can I just say something? Okay, just one other thing, if I may, okay? Don't be careful.
Okay, I won't be careful. Earlier, how religious are you?
Okay, I'll answer that in a second.
Yeah.
But when you said earlier, you know, what offends you, and I said labels, I was also going to say, but say it anyway. Say it anyway. Why should it matter that I am offended? In fact, if we're going to, again, have honest conversations that lead to real solutions, and by the way, no solutions that are real can come from dishonest conversations, then frankly, offend me so I have a reason to engage with you. So, what was that question again?
The question was, do you have...
You have difficult people here, don't you?
Now we are four hosts here. I just wonder, do you like have a prayer rug? Do you pray five times a day?
Yes, well, okay. Those are two different questions.
Okay.
Yes, I do have a prayer rug. And I don't know how my mother feels about this because I actually haven't told her, but what the hell, I'm on, you know, Scandinavian TV, so I'll say it. My prayer rug from childhood is now oriented towards my bookcases, not to Mecca. Because those bookcases are the symbol of the human creativity that God has vested in all of us. For me, this is what is so beautiful about being a creature of this majestic creator. And as for, do you pray five times a day? The answer is no. I pray 12 times a day.
On that rug?
Nope. No, I have honest conversations with God. And rather than being told, this is what you must say at this assigned time of the day, washing certain parts of your body and oriented towards one specific direction, Saudi Arabia, which is the very antithesis, the very opposite of the kind of Islam that represents me. Saudi Arabia is the very opposite. There, you know what's interesting? The Quran says, no matter which way you turn, east or west, there is the face of God. Why then do we need to orient ourselves only to Mecca?
You talk about individual thinking, the group think is the problem.
Group think is the problem. That's coming right from tribal culture,
Is it a cultural problem? Is it a religious problem, or is it just a problem, you know, with a society?
Well, first of all, I mean, no society is free of groupthink. And by the way, you know, I've been to Sweden in enough visits to understand that the fear that many Swedes, Muslim and non-Muslim, feel about even touching these kinds of issues does come from a certain groupthink, for sure. Let me just quickly say that it is this fear, this groupthink, of avoiding these honest conversations that I believe is really at the heart of what allows, I'm not trying to be partisan here, but that allows an organization like the Sweden Democrats to rise in power. You see, when you avoid the honest questions because you fear offending, you fear how the group, the public, will see you, then you frustrate many voters who do have legitimate questions. Those voters will naturally go to start listening to those marginal politicians who are addressing these questions, and they'll turn the marginal into the mainstream. It's an abdication, a giving up of leadership by the mainstream politicians. This is why, first and foremost, we need to be honest in our conversations.
Is this what happens? You've been to Afghanistan a lot with your organization.
10 times I've been there.
Yes, and what is your impression? Is the problem?
First, I'd like to say to you that I think if you look at the Middle East, Pakistan, Afghanistan, Taliban, the whole damn thing. 80% of the problems is not religious. It's not the Quran. It is extreme poverty and hopelessness, you see. That was driving the hot spots in the Middle East. When I was sitting in Cairo, we worked a lot with Aswan Dam and so on. I was there quite a lot. I saw 800,000 high school students come out every year, 600,000 out of unemployment. I saw the young men sitting in the cafes of Cairo, hopeless, no future, could not create a family, could not sustain themselves, easy prey for the Muslim Brotherhood, hating Israel, hating the United States. That's poverty and hopelessness. And when we work in Afghanistan, we don't have a problem with Islam. We have, of course, to follow the Quran, and we have Ayatollah blessing us and all that, you know. You have to, you know, adopt to the culture. But what you need to do is to lift them up of their extreme poverty. If you do that, we can forget about all...
Sorry, Percy, we can't forget about...
No, not forget about
no,
it.
No, can I just say...
Almost forget about it.
the problem with the almost is that it's a very big almost.
20%.
Let's remember that the men who flew those planes into the World Trade Centers, you know, in 2001, were at the very least middle class, and some of them came from very wealthy upper class families.
We have to say goodbye to you now, because we have a lot to talk about.